Namaste. Today I would like to talk to you about japa mantra meditation or japa mala meditation. So this is obviously a meditation technique that is quite popular at the moment, both in the East and the West. And I wanted to share a little bit about this technique with you. It's something that I started practicing around the time that I did my very first teacher training. And I really, really loved this type of practice because it's very, very helpful for people that tend to be very busy mentally and struggle to refine their attention to a single point or to nothingness, to that internal quiet. So it's certainly something that helps us to withdraw from sensory stimulation, which is a form of pratyahara. So today with this focus, we need a set of mala beads, and which I have a beautiful set here, which are a favorite pair of mine from Blooming Lotus Jewelry. Jen, the founder and creator, is a great friend of mine. However, what I'd like to really point out and emphasize that is really essential to know is that these mala beads that I wear around my neck and that you see most people in the West wearing, these are essentially just a expression of fashion, and they're not traditionally used for japa meditation. So a pair of mala beads that we use for this technique are something that we keep very private and very personal. So this is why I'm using this mala necklace today to demonstrate this practice, whereas I have my own personal set of mala beads that I use specifically for my mantra or japa meditation. A very common combination or type of mala bead that we use for japa mala is, you'll see it a lot in India, is an alternating set of Rudraksha and clear quartz crystal. So this is said to be the Shiv Shakti set of mala. And of course, there are always 108 beads with the guru bead at the very bottom. So I'm going to take these ones off and give you a little bit of a demonstration here of how we use them. There is a specific technique that that we use and how to hold them, which is very important to learn, and it can be a little bit tricky when you're first starting out, but it's something that obviously becomes very natural with consistent practice. So we traditionally hold them in the right hand, and we want to find the guru bead, so that center bead there, and we want to ensure that we never cross that bead, okay? And what we're going to do is also, we're never going to use the index finger to practice this style of meditation or this technique. You're going to take your mala beads, and look, it can be any mala beads. It certainly doesn't have to be the Shiv Shakti. It might be sandalwood. Look, it could be plastic beads, whatever you can get your hands on. Don't be too particular, because it's the practice that's important, not necessarily the material. Although natural, of course, is ideal, please don't let that inhibit you from beginning a practice. So the hand technique that we use, you'll take it into your right hand, and you can see I've got the bead sitting over the top of my middle finger here, and we're going to start by bringing the thumb and the middle finger onto this bead, this first bead that sits just above the guru bead. And this is the first bead that we're going to chant our mantra on. Now, sometimes holding the bead, just literally holding it and saying your mantra is enough. You might feel comfortable rolling the bead or like massaging it between your fingers. This is a really nice technique, and this is something that I personally do. And you're going to say your mantra, and I'll get to the mantras in a moment, but you're going to say your mantra as you hold or as you roll this bead. Once you've completed your mantra, you will then simply use your thumb and push down and find the next bead. And this can seem a little tricky when you're first starting out, because your eyes are closed and sometimes you can feel a little fumbly, or am I doing it on the same bead, or did I skip a bead? But I want you to not worry about that, and of course keep coming back to the practice, because it's the practice that's important, not to be perfect. But the consistency is key here. We chant our mantra on one bead, and then we move it down so that we're not going the direction of the guru bead, we're going the other way. So we move it down, we say our mantra, and then we go the next one, move it down, we say our mantra, Next one, move it down. We say our mantra and rolling. I like to roll mine. It just keeps me there and attentive to what I'm doing. So you literally keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Hopefully you can see that I'm moving, I'm shifting. So you would obviously chant your mantra on each bead and until you get to the very end. So imagine we've gone around 108 times. So I'm going to go all the way around to the guru bead. And this is when you know that you've finished your 108 rounds. So even though your eyes are closed, you become aware that you've come to the guru bead. When you come to your guru bead, you might like to finish your practice there. Depending on how long your mantra is, 108 rounds might take you a very long time. It could take you 15 minutes, 50 minutes. It could take you a couple of hours. So it depends on what mantra you use as to how long essentially this is going to take. If you would like to continue past 108 rounds, what we need to do is we actually need to flip the set of beads around so that you're no longer going to skip over or go over the guru bead. We never want to move over that guru bead. So it can, again, be a little bit tricky when we're first starting out, but literally what you're going to do is you're going to flip the hand and find that same bead that you were just on and you flipped it so that it's back to the same way as it was when you very first started. And then you would continue going around and around and around through your 108 rounds, okay? All the way, you'll sense the guru bead, you'll feel it coming. Even if there's not a big stone there, it'll generally have tassels or something that you will know that you've come to that end of the round. Then again, we would flip over the set of beads, readjust the grip, and perhaps you might like to begin again. So that's the technique that we use with the hand. And you know, it can get a little feel like a lot of effort in the hands, but it's something that will feel very natural after some time, and that will happen quite quickly as well. It's good to keep your mala beads in a little pouch or something that's very special and quite personal for you. It keeps them clean and clear of just any dust or water or anybody else picking them up, because we generally want to keep them very personal. You could choose to wear them as well around your neck. However, the mala beads that you practice meditation on should not be worn as like a fashion accessory. We tend to wear them around the neck but tucked inside our clothing. So you might see sometimes people wearing them around their neck, but instead of having them on display, they will often be inside underneath their layer of clothing. Or you might see, which is quite common in Buddhist meditation practices, that they have them in a little pouch. The Hare Krishna people do a similar method with their beads as well. They keep them in a pouch. They might be sitting on the bus or on a train or in a car or walking, doing a walking meditation, and they'll be chanting with their beads as they're walking or going out with their day or on with their day. But they'll be inside that pouch. And of course, you'll see that becomes a very personal experience. That's our mala practice. Now, with regards to your meditation, your mantra that you might like to choose, your mantra could be something that is given to you through your lineage, through your spiritual lineage. It could be through a guru, it could be through a teacher, or honestly, it could be something that resonates for you. It could be any mantra. It could be the mantra Om. It could be Om Mani Padme Hum. It could be Sat Nam. Anything you like. So Om Namo Narayani, anything that resonates for you. Of course, when we're first starting, it's nice to start with something quite short. The very first mantra that I personally was given to do this style of meditation was Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Now, it's nice to know the meanings of the mantra that you choose. And these days with the internet, we can really find out this information very, very easily. We can literally Google a mantra and learn all about it. It could be a mantra to a deity, to Ganesh, or whatever resonates for you. So this is something you don't want to get too hung up on. You pick something that feels good, that you feel comfortable translating or communicating. And when you say your mantra, it doesn't have to be said verbally. You don't have to literally verbally speak it when you're doing this practice. It's something that you could also just say over and over in your mind, which you'll find in most instances tends to be what's most natural for you. It's a very quiet internal practice. Initially, however, if it helps you with your practice, of course you can say your mantra verbally so that it really resonates and vibrates through the body and becomes something that also vocally you send it through into that bead. So it helps stay consistent and keeps the mind very focused on the practice and on what you're doing, which is ultimately why we're doing this form of practice, to quieten, to streamline our thought and our mental attention. And therefore, it's a really nice meditation practice to use when we're really starting out in meditation. It helps us to learn how to really quieten and focus, to then perhaps just sit and to sit, maybe focusing on the breath or sitting and trying to drop into that internal quiet and that nothingness. So I hope that this video resonated for you and it's given you a little introductory insight into this very ancient practice of meditation. Don't get hung up on what your mala beads look like or where they're from. However, of course, it is nice to perhaps pick some up on your travels. If you're in Bali or India, we can find some really beautiful pieces, or maybe you could make your own set by hand yourself. Other than that, the only other important thing to know is that whatever mantra that you choose for this practice, it's important to stay consistent with that mantra. Stick with it for some time, practice daily, maybe twice daily, and stay with your chosen mantra for at least a month. Some people might stay with a mantra for a whole lifetime, but this is a really important thing. The consistency is where it's at and where we get the most out of this practice. If you personally have any really great experiences with this practice, or maybe you have something you'd like to share, or maybe you have a question about this practice, please don't hesitate to get in touch. Otherwise, I look forward to sharing more with you very soon. Stay tuned. Namaste.